represent, as well as Alan Lichtenstein, who's with me from Nevada, and my associate, Paul Masahara. May it please the court. Indigent, psychotic, and suicidal, Mr. Brown was involuntarily admitted to Rawson-Neal, Nevada's state hospital in Las Vegas, and then after 2 days, escorted to the door, placed in a waiting taxi, and directed to board a Greyhound bus for transport to a strange city where he knew nobody, that is Sacramento, my city of practice, with a plastic bag of medication, 3 bottles of Ensure, no identification, no money, and a one-page discharge note that said, call 911 upon arrival. Unbelievably, this was not an isolated case. As we found after filing the complaint, at least 1,500 other indigent psychiatric patients had been similarly dismissed from the care of Rawson-Neal in Las Vegas and dispersed to cities throughout the country, some of them getting off the bus prior to arrival and committing suicide, others never having been heard from again. And these persons, indigent, left to seek services in cities where they were foreign, have been severely abused. When Mr. Brown filed his case, Rawson-Neal was investigated and cited for a host of violations, including violations of the federal standards for discharge planning. The court below, on a 12B6 motion to dismiss, initially granted that demotion on all the federal claims, and set a status check conference to decide to determine how the plaintiff sought to proceed thereafter, but vacated that conference when plaintiffs filed a motion for reconsideration, which made very clear that plaintiffs were standing on the complaint and indicated in the opening brief that we intended to appeal had if the court did not reconsider and revise its rulings.
I don't understand your statement you just made. As a district court judge, when I gave an order, I anticipated it would be accepted. I didn't make suppositions. Why do you say that from that alone that you sufficiently advised that you're standing on your brief? The words are very easy. You can just file it. That's what he asked to have done.
Your Honor, I agree with you. We did not make dispositively clear that we were standing on that brief.
But it made clear it doesn't even say anything having to do with standing on the brief.
Well, we did say, Your Honor, and we repeated.
You said you wanted a reconsideration. That's far different.
Well, yes, Your Honor. What I meant to represent to the court was both in the initial brief requesting reconsideration and in the reply brief, we said in order to save time, which would otherwise be disposed on an appeal, and to permit the parties rationally and expeditiously to address these points, the court should revise its decision accordingly, and we listed, and I think quite persuasively, and I'm prepared to argue those exact points to the court today, why the court erred in every respect.
Now, counsel, let me just ask you this. As I read the court's order, it was not in the alternative. It did not say either file an amended complaint or a statement that you are not amending. It merely said you may file an amended complaint. Am I reading it correctly, or is there some other order in the file?
You're absolutely correct on the initial motion ruling, that is, on the initial motion to dismiss, as well as in response to the motion for reconsideration. The court never told us that either file or that we were directed to file an amended complaint. It gave us an opportunity to file an amended complaint, and we chose not to file an amended complaint because we wanted to be precisely here.
And the the time elapsed between the order stating that you may file an amended complaint and the dismissal with prejudice was, what, about 2 weeks? Something.
Well, less than 30 days, Your Honor. The court granted us 14 days in ruling on the motion for reconsideration. The court granted us 14 days to file an amended complaint. And then subsequent to that, sua sponte granted another 7 days. And when we received the judgment dismissing the complaint in all regards, that's what we were waiting for, so that we could file our brief. It is true.
That was the problem. In the federal court, dismissing the complaint is not a final order. You have to dismiss the action. If you appeal a dismissal of the complaint, we have no jurisdiction, because we don't get a jurisdiction until there's been a judgment dismissing the action. How can we rule on this case under those circumstances?
Well, Your Honor, a judgment was entered. That's precisely the point. But I agree with Your Honor that normally an order is not appealable, and we were waiting for the judgment itself, and we filed an immediate notice of appeal after getting that judgment.
But that's a Rule 41 dismissal. That's not a 12b-6 dismissal.
Yes, Your Honor, I agree with you. And the order, however, said that the order before the final order, the order that came in response to the motion for reconsideration, was a dismissal without prejudice of the federal claims, as well as
the court ruled on each of your claims on the merits.
Yes, Your Honor. Yes, the court ruled in the motion for reconsideration, well, initially on the 12B motion, and again on the motion for reconsideration on each of the federal claims. And those are the ones that we briefed before, Your Honor. I understand the concern that we did not address in our opening brief the 41B dismissal.
Isn't it waived?
Well, believe me, Your Honor, that is a big concern to me. I can only say that it's in your discretion whether to dismiss this case on 41B when it is clear that there was no extraordinary time that elapsed between.
It is a discretion. We either have or we don't.
Well, Your Honor, we address
it. Isn't this sort of thing, well, it's okay, let's go hear it. We don't have power to act unless the judgment's just been dismissed.
Well, we appealed, Your Honor. We appealed. First of all, there's no, as far as we can tell.
There's a judgment of dismissal.
There's a judgment.
Beyond the order, there is a judgment.
There's a judgment. Yes, of course, there's a judgment of dismissal, and that's what we appealed. We addressed the verdict issues, and we showed that, of the five issues in our response brief, we showed it of the five issues that the court could consider in dismissing an appeal because the party did not participate in the judicial process, which is so totally contrary to what we did. We also addressed the abuse of discretion of the district court in depth to show that this is not a case where we believe we had given clear notice to the court that we intended to appeal if he stood on the rulings that he had indicated, that this is not the kind of case that where the public's interest should be just totally disregarded. And Judge Mann's dismissal 141B grounds allowed to stand because of the manifest injustice. And this is not a case where we attempted to sandbag the defense by raising an issue in our responsive brief. We addressed the issue very completely after it was raised in the opposition brief by the defendants. But I would like to move on to the substantive merits, if I may. And very specifically, of course, there were seven federal claims. I think I can't in the time.
No, you can't. But I'm curious to have you the one that at least causes me some question in my mind is the statutory EMTALA claim. Could you talk briefly about that one?
Well, yes, Your Honor. EMTALA was designed. It didn't anticipate this precise set of facts, but it was designed to protect persons who came into a stabilized. Our complaint specifically alleged that Mr. Brown was not, in fact, stabilized.
Did he come in on an emergency basis?
He came in on an emergency basis, suicidal and psychotic. And the Rawson-Neal Hospital advertised itself as having the capacity to deal with emergency psychiatric circumstances. So he was, in fact, drugged. And then not even
these
transferred.
Are the allegations, and right now that's what we have. So.
That's right. Those are the allegations, and there's no basis for the court to imagine some other possibility or to just disbelieve and disregard the well-pleaded allegations in the complaint and to strike that claim. So the EMTALA claim, we think, is a very strong claim, but we also feel that the Eighth Amendment cruel and unusual claim is well-founded, and the reason for that is that the man is in custody of a psychiatric hospital because he's suicidal and psychotic, and instead of treating him, which they have the capacity to do, they take him and they banish him to some foreign district.
But I'm sympathetic to what you're saying, and I don't want my question to suggest otherwise about what happened to your client, but how is that akin to confinement, that they take him out of the hospital setting and throw him into a bus? I'm accepting everything you're saying, but I don't know how that makes an Eighth Amendment claim that is predicated on confinement when essentially he wants to be confined. Well, he's just deconfined.
Your Honor, there's no... whether he wants to be confined or not, we just assume, let's assume that you have a very vulnerable person who has been involuntarily hospitalized, who's then getting some kind of care. He's incapable of dealing with the circumstances of life on his own. Instead, he's then put into a worse situation, which is out in the big wide world, knowing nobody, going to some...
Yeah, but why is that an Eighth Amendment claim?
Well, because it's cruel and unusual. That's the principle. And I thought that Judge Rutledge's analogy or analysis of banishment as something that's unheard of in our punitive experience was very apt. That's essentially what happened to Mr. Brown. But additionally, I think the Fourth Amendment claim is very strong as well. He was, in fact, taken out of the hospital, escorted to a taxi, and directed to go to the Greyhound bus station where he was being taken and board a bus. He was drugged again, and he is not his own will, his own personal will to do something else is quite contrary to what Judge Mahan suggested, which was that why didn't he just throw his ticket away and walk away? Well, the courts have said that submission to authority is seizure, and in this instance...
That's a Fourth Amendment question, which is also one of your claims, though.
Pardon me?
You're talking about Fourth Amendment.
Yes, Fourth Amendment.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did you want to save some rebuttal time, counsel?
I would like to save 2 minutes. I regret that I haven't been able to cover and address all the other claims, but we did adequately.
Nothing is waived by not being argued orally. So.
Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court, my name is Linda Anderson, appearing on behalf of all of the defendants except for Dr. White, who is represented by David Pruitt. We feel very strongly that plaintiff has waived the arguments here today by not raising anything or even almost mischaracterizing to this court what was before it. It didn't mention the order in its...
You know, counsel, I have difficulty with looking at this under Rule 41, and I may be the only one who has this difficulty, but the court said to the plaintiff, you have the opportunity to amend, and the plaintiff chose not to amend. And the order did not say you must either amend or inform me what you intend to do, in which case doing nothing would be a violation of a court order. But I don't see how choosing not to do something that you have permission but not a requirement to do is a violation of a court order. I just, and I know we have cases that go that direction. action, but I just have to tell you, it makes absolutely no sense to me at all.
And I would like to share with you part of, I think, the district court's response is to you, the Ninth Circuit. The Ninth Circuit has always come across and said they should be given every opportunity to amend. So to even suggest to the plaintiffs that they should stand on their pleadings might actually...
That's not my point. This is a situation in which there is allegedly a failure or refusal to follow a court order, but I don't see what it was that he had to do that he didn't do.
What he had to do, when you look at Edwards versus Menlo Park, is to instruct the court that it... That's what I'm saying to you.
It makes no sense to me.
I know that makes no sense, Your Honor, but let's think about this in terms of where it goes for all of the parties. In that motion to recommend, you know, the plaintiff actually had 5 months to amend the complaint or to make the decision. And what the court, what you're suggesting, though, is that the court couldn't move its docket along because of very simple statement.
No, I'm not. I'm suggesting that the court could be more clear in what it's requiring of a plaintiff in this situation, which is you have leave to amend, but if you decide not to, let me know.
And I think the court, though, the district court shared your perspective, for instance, on the Imtala complaint, that the plaintiffs may have wanted to amend to make a clear claim. The court spent a lot of time detailing in both the orders.
You know, I understand what you're saying, but it doesn't really answer my concern, which is that I don't understand how a court in this situation can enter a Rule 41B dismissal.
If the court shared what I have the same incredulity, that they would stand on the pleadings, and I did.
No, that's not my point at all.
I know that's not your point, but I want to offer to you, Your Honor, that is part of where the court was coming from. There was actually no silence. I mean, when you get an order saying, you know, the court gently reminded them this is not a final order, changed it from a 59E to a 54B, said this is not final, gave them 14 more days to amend their complaint, and they responded with silence, and then a very strong admonishment, 7 more days, there's no excuse.
And it says it will be dismissed, but it doesn't say it will be dismissed under Rule 41. This started out as a 12B6, and the court looked at the merits of every single claim. So when the court just says amend or I'll dismiss, it still doesn't say you have to amend, or you have to talk to me, or the dismissal will be under Rule 41.
I ask you to look at this then from the defendant's perspective, because it must have felt very strange to you looking at our pleadings. You probably felt you had gone back to before WMX technology.
Well, let me just say, though, that let's assume for the sake of my questions that we disagree with you about the state of the pleadings, that we think that they do state a claim or more than one claim already.
The issue here is that they did not stand on the pleadings until the reply brief. If they had made this very clear and had unilaterally converted it to a final decision, we would have had very different briefing before this court. All these questions that you're asking right now is, did the plaintiff give a sufficient complaint to plead, are not really before you because
to my mind, maybe they should be, because I don't understand why this is a proper 41B dismissal.
And this is why if plaintiff had taken the right approach in the opening brief, you would have had these issues and we would have had much more of this discussion.
Let's assume, well, the merits were briefed. Let's assume for the sake of argument here that the dismissal under Rule 41B is not proper, that it's an abuse of discretion. What happens then? Do we turn then to the merits, which the district court already decided as a matter of law? Or what? What do we do?
And I suggest you that's part of the problem.
No, no, answer the question.
I want you to assume that 41B is wrong. I think the best case scenario for us is if they are standing on their pleadings, because it would be a complete waste of resources with the pleadings that are before this court to return them and say the court, because it would be done in a motion
to
judgment.
So let me see if I understand your answer, because it sounded like it was off to one side a little bit, but I may be misunderstanding it. If I understand your position, it is this. If the district court erroneously dismissed under 41B, then we should go and look at the pleading that as a matter of law whether it states any claims or not, as was the original discussion had at the district court level on under 12b-6, then that we should go ahead and do that, in your view.
I think the briefing would have to be done differently to give full fairness to us, because what I defended in my pleadings is what the judge's order was, which was to give leave to amend.
So then, and I don't understand your previous answer. So what should we do if we disagree with the Rule 41B? Do we send it back? Do we decide it on the merits?
I think that you can decide on the merits, that the court was correct in finding that they failed to state a sufficient claim.
And can we decide the opposite of that? In other words, we don't say, well, we can reach it only if we agree with one party. The question is, if we don't agree with 41B, do we reach the merits or not reach the merits, yes or no?
Here's the academic issue that we're posed with. What happened here is we had some strong allegations about misconduct, about discharge from the facility. What they tried to do was to elevate those two federal and constitutional claims. I submit to you that those federal constitutional claims are not adequately briefed, and that their complaint made a very good narrative and had some beginnings, but they are trying to take the jurisprudence we have for people with mental illness and change it to make it be that upon your release, all those conditions comply. And I find that very disturbing, because we have lots of people in our society with mental illness who are on medication, who are free to travel about the country, who are free to do things. So which one of those claims would you look at?
I'm having difficulty because I think we're not communicating very well. I'm just trying to figure out if the Rule 41B dismissal is wrong, if we were to decide that the district court made a mistake doing that form of dismissal, then do we have to send it back to the district court or do we then look at it as a 12B6 dismissal and look at each claim as a matter of law here? It's a where does it go question. I don't want you to re-argue the merits.
Okay.
I just want to know who should decide.
I think that this court should decide, but I'm concerned that the court doesn't have enough in their pleadings before them to make that decision at this time because of the nature of the way this case came
to. Well, that's why that was a 12B6 motion initially, and so, well, okay.
But I don't know that the district court can do much more than what it has already done, and so that's where I'm having trouble answering your question.
What did you mean a few minutes ago when you said they stated they were standing on their pleadings for the first time in their reply? What were you talking about?
The first time that I've been
aware. What reply?
The reply to this court.
Okay.
So the reply to this court is the first time we have a declaration.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure you were not talking about any earlier reply briefs. You're talking about the reply briefs in the appeal.
And in fairness, you know, to the plaintiffs, I don't, because they didn't make that declaration until their reply brief. Their briefing doesn't characterize looking at exactly what's in their pleadings and was substantiated. So I guess, Judge Graber, I'm having trouble answering your question because I think the pleadings are not before you to make a decision. You could return it back to the district court, but I think the district court would be in the same quandary because the district court felt that it had given them every opportunity. And in fairness, I do feel the court, it was a blatant disregard of the court's order to not respond at all when they were given plenty of opportunity and a direct order to do so. So, yes, could this court do that? But perhaps this court would require further briefing from us on those specific issues because the pleadings before the court are not, I couldn't respond as though they were standing on the pleading when I wrote my brief because they hadn't made that declaration yet. So if there are any further questions, I will give a few minutes to Mr. Pruitt.
Good morning, Honorable Judges. David Pruitt on behalf of Dr. White. I want to jump to the Rule 41 question that you had, Judge Graber. understand your concern about the correctness of Judge Mahan's ruling, but I believe that you can't get there. And the reason for that belief is that when an appellant fails to raise a point in their appellant's opening brief, they necessarily waive it. So whether they had an argument on appeal that the Rule 41 dismissal was erroneous, they didn't assert it. When a party fails to assert a point in their opening papers, they necessarily waive it. In this instance, the defense relied upon that waiver. It's brief, and I think that what the Attorney General is getting at is that the brief that was filed was written the way it was because there was no request to challenge the Rule 41 determination. We all know that the reason that this court is here is to address the errors of the district courts when they are made, but those errors, this court is not empowered to control the courts to find those errors and then grant relief. It has to be properly requested. And for that proper request to occur, an appellee has to be told about it before the reply brief. And on your other alternative, and I hesitate because I don't want to waive the 41 issue, but in terms of looking at this from an abuse of discretion or a matter of law, there are a couple other things that come to mind here. First, plaintiff's attorney this morning acknowledged that the encapsulated point of this case is that there was a failure to comply with a discharge plan under the Code of Federal Rules. And I just want to point out that there's no private right of action for such a claim. In fact, the only effect of the rules that are being talked about is the regulation of Medicare provider status. So whether or not a Medicare provider may be penalized, an assessment imposed against them, whether their participation can be revoked, that's the only thing that those rules pertain to. And I would point out that they are relying upon CFR 42 CFR 482.43. The provisions around that, going right to the bottom line, 42 CFR 402.21 allows for judicial review only after exhaustion of administrative remedies. Now, we're two steps removed from that because it's talking about judicial review of a provider sanction, which is not what we have here. The other thing, Your Honor, you mentioned, Judge Graber, this idea of EMTALA, and I do want to comment upon Judge Mahan's analysis in this case. I think that he hit the nail on the head. There was no injury as a result of the alleged discharge, and although plaintiff has made some issue about medications, what plaintiff also alleged in the complaint was that the medications were therapeutic. They were antipsychotic medications, so they were meant to address the problem that this man had. And moreover, when you look at it the way that Judge Mahan did, and I think that you have to under these circumstances, especially when we're talking about 41D, abuse of discretion, things of that nature that you're suggesting may be mixed in here, there's no Article III standing for that claim. And I would suggest to this court that when you go through Judge Mahan's orders, both the order of dismissal and the order of reconsideration, that embedded in those orders is this premise that there's not an Article III injury. There's therefore no jurisdiction for any relief that's been requested here.
Thank you, counsel.
Thanks for the time.
I believe Mr. Barron has a little bit of rebuttal time remaining.
The order of the court, which granted plaintiff 7 additional days to file an amended complaint, which was issued on July 8, made no mention of any 41B sanction. It said, it is hereby issued a subsequent order that said that he was appalled that we had not taken the opportunity to amend and was therefore dismissing the complaint under 41B and directed the clerk to enter an order. The order didn't say anything about 41B. The order said that the judgment was entered with prejudice on the claims, and that's what we appealed. Certainly, in hindsight, I would love to have put the arguments that we have in our reply brief, in our opening brief, to show why that was an incorrect order. It was not a proper sanction. We had been participating fully and with alacrity and responsiveness to everything in this case. And we had made clear, I believe, that we felt very strongly about the legal arguments we were making. We had set out the facts in detail, so there's no additional facts that would have been included in response to an offer or an opportunity to amend.
What do we do with the Ninth Circuit cases which bind us that say if you do not put it in your opening brief, you cannot rely on a reply brief? Do we just overlook those? Do we go in back to decide something different?
Well, I don't know that those inextricably bind the court to an absolutely irrational conclusion, Your Honor. I think
in
this case,
it's irrational in our decisions. And if you want to charge that, it's fine. But we still have to follow the Ninth Circuit rules, whether we think they're irrational or not. And you haven't really, for one-third of the panel, you haven't yet convinced me that there is some exception in those cases which allow you to raise this issue.
Well, I haven't seen anything, Your Honor, that denies this court the opportunity to, in its own discretion, reject the irrational, I'd say, application of a rule that waived the right to proceed with a case which had been so fully briefed, well represented, and actually presented to the court for decision.
As I understand, you don't see it, but we have to follow our precedent. We take an oath that we follow precedent. You can ask for a bank and change those precedents.
Well, Your Honor, there's no reference in the response brief, in the opposition brief, to any hard and fast binding rule that prevents this circuit, this court, Your Honors, from not treating that failure to address the 41B as a waiver. There's nothing that says that, and we did not brief that because, in fact, it was not presented in the opposition brief.
What?
The waiver argument, Your Honor.
The waiver argument was one that you had to make, and you didn't do it in your blue brief. What our cases say is doing it in your reply brief doesn't count. So I'm having difficulty. I haven't seen where you've distinguished those cases. Maybe you've got a right to go in back and change it. But we take an oath that we're going to follow the law. We just can't willy-nilly because we'd like to do something different.
I don't think you're bound, Your Honor, to do something that is totally irrational, contrary to public policy, contrary to the interests of the public, to follow something that was not, in fact, briefed in their response brief. There's no argument that we have, in fact, waived the opposition to the 41B judgment.
Are you suggesting that the cases that we have that say if you fail to raise the issue in your opening brief, cannot raise it later in your reply brief, are irrational and that we should just not look at them?
I think there's a question of the new points. That's what generally, that's how that's applied. If you try to get into a new area on reply that you hadn't properly raised on your appeal, but on the merits of this case, we raised every argument in our opening brief. That's the only thing. The only thing we failed to address was something that was not on the merits.
Waiver. Yeah. Okay. I have your point. I don't fully understand it, but I have your point.
Thank you, counsel. The case just argued is submitted, and we appreciate the arguments of all three counsel. With that, we will be adjourned for this morning's session.